Hello friends, as we move ahead with the celebrations of completing 30 years in practice at Vinod Kothari and Company, we again present to you a web lecture on the giving of loans, guarantee and security and making of investments. So what are the applicable provisions under the Companies Act 2013? Section 179, Section 185, Section 186 and 187. To put it broadly, these are the four sections that mainly deal with the topic of today's web lecture. So let's move ahead with the first section, 179. Section 179 deals with the powers of board. So who is the approving authority for giving loans, guarantee and security and making of investments? It is the board of directors of a company who have to approve the granting of loan or making of investment or guarantee or security in connection with a loan at their meeting. This power cannot be exercised by way of a circular resolution. Further, this power can also be delegated to any committee or a principal officer of a company. And such delegation has to be filed with the ROC in e-form MGT 14. It is also to be kept in mind that when the board delegates this power, it has to be a unanimous delegation. That means the consent of all the board members in the meeting is required for such delegation. Generally, many companies delegate this power up to a certain threshold for ease of business operations. So now we come to one of the most controversial sections, basically, which used to be a very controversial section, section 185, which previously used to prohibit giving of loan to directors and the entities in which the director is interested. As a quick snapshot, while the Companies Amendment Act 2017, the entire section has been substituted to make it partly prohibitory and partly restrictive. The rate of interest has been aligned with that of section 186.57. The section, however, still excludes the directors of subsidiary, JV and associate companies. So, dealing with the first part of the section, section 185/1, which is a complete prohibited part of section 185. It casts absolute prohibition on a company to give loan directly or indirectly or advance any loan, including any loan represented by a book debt, or give guarantee or provide security in connection with a loan availed by any director of the company or its holding company, any partner or relative of the above, or a firm in which the above director or his relative is a partner. So, to these entities, to these person, the loan cannot be given. Moving ahead to the next part of the section, which lays down restriction on the company to extend loan or guarantee or security to the entities in which the director is interested, unless it complies with the conditions mentioned therein. A company may, by passing a special resolution, directly or indirectly advance any loan, including any loan represented by a book debt, or give any guarantee or provide any security in connection with a loan availed by any person in whom any of the director of the company is interested. The explanatory statement of such special resolution must disclose the full particulars of the loans given or guarantee given or security provided, and must also state the purpose of the said loan, guarantee or security. So, who are the person in whom director is interested and which comes under the purview of the restricted portion of section 185/2? Any private company of which any such director is a director or member. Any body corporate at a general meeting of which not less than 25% of the total voting power may be exercised or controlled by any such director or by two or more such directors together. Or any body corporate, the board of directors, managing director or manager whereof is accustomed to act in accordance with the directions or instructions of the board or of any director or directors of the lending company. So the three clauses here, the first clause is clear enough to state that a private company in which my director is a director or member is an entity or is a person in whom my director is interested. The next clause, which says that if the borrowing entity is such where my director together with any other director of my company could exercise or could control. So the word control is quite broad enough to go even layers or go beyond direct holding in the borrowing company to see whether my directors control 25% of the total voting power. The third clause is very subjective and circumstantial, where the person accusing or claiming that the borrowing company's board or MD or manager is accustomed to act has to actually prove it. The onus of proving that the borrowing entity's management is accustomed to act as per directions of the directors of the lending company is on the person who actually puts the acquisition on the transaction. Section 185 also provides certain exemptions. Exemption has been granted where the loan has been given to the MD or WTD as part of conditions of service which has been extended to all employees or pursuant to a scheme approved by a special resolution. Further, if a loan is in the ordinary course of business where interest charged is not less than the prevailing yield of a government security of 1, 3, 5 or 10 years, in that case also, the transaction does not attract Section 185. Thirdly, a loan made by a holding company to its wholly owned subsidiary is also exempted, provided the wholly owned subsidiary utilizes the money for its principal business activities. Coming to guarantee or security, the exemption has been granted to the guarantee or security provided by a holding company in respect of a loan made to its wholly owned subsidiary or a loan made by bank or financial institutions to its subsidiaries where the subsidiary utilizes the money for its principal business activity. So here as we see that whenever a holding company extends loan or gives guarantee or security to its subsidiary or wholly owned subsidiary, the subsidiary or wholly owned subsidiary has to utilize such money for its principal business activity. So how will one come to know that the money has been used or utilized for its principal business activity? Well, one will have to examine this on case-to-case basis, or a company or a checker or auditor may ask for utilization certificates from the subsidiary, can ask the lending company to show that, to show whether it has received such declaration or undertaking from the subsidiary company that the money lent has been utilized for principal business activities of the subsidiary. Section 185 has been made or has been drafted in a strict sense to avoid any conflict of interest or siphoning of funds in a company for the benefit and interest of the directors or their or its entities. So let's come to the overview. So, loan to directors, if you're a public company, or are you a private company, or in a case where you're a government company. Coming to a case where you are a private company, do you have no corporate members? Your borrowings from banks, financial institutions is less than twice of the paid up capital or rupees 50 crores, and there is no default and repayment of borrowings. If the answer is yes, you are exempted. White, the MC notification which came in 2015. If your answer is no, then we'll have to check further whether Section 185 is attracted. In case you're a government company, one will have to check whether the approval of the administrative ministry has been obtained. If yes, then you're exempted. If no, then we'll have to check further. Are you advancing loan to director or giving guarantee or providing any security in connection with any loan taken by any director of company or of a company which is its holding company or any partner or relative of any such director or any firm at which any such director or relative is a partner? If the answer is no, then such loan is allowed. However, if the answer is yes, then we move ahead to check further whether this loan has been given to the MD or WTD as a part of conditions of service extended by a company to all its employees, or is it pursuant to any scheme approved by members by special resolution, or whether the loan or guarantee or security given is for due repayment of any loan of the company in its ordinary course of business, and the interest rate is as per the prevailing yield of 1, 3, 5 or 10 year government security bond, or any loan by, or is it a loan given by a holding company to its wholly owned subsidiary, or any guarantee or security provided by holding in respect of any loan made to its subsidiary company, provided the loan is used by subsidiary for principal business activity, or the guarantee or security provided by holding in respect of any loan made by any bank or financial institutions to its subsidiary company, provided the loan is utilized by the subsidiary for its principal business activity. If it is a yes, then such loan is allowed and does not attract the provisions of Section 185. If the answer is no, then this loan is absolutely prohibited by virtue of the provisions of Section 185. Coming to the restrictive part of the section, that if my loan has been given to any person in whom the director is interested, that we just learned in the previous slide, if the answer is, then such loan is allowed. However, if the answer is yes, that the loan is being given to such entity where my director is interested, then whether the condition is being satisfied. So what's the condition? Whether special resolution has been passed in the company and the explanatory statement has disclosed the full particulars of the loan or guarantee or security and the purpose for which such loan or guarantee or security has been provided, and the and the purpose of the said loan. If it is a yes, then such loan is allowed, such loan or guarantee or security is allowed. And if it's a no, then the same is prohibited. So coming to an interesting question, whether deposits are covered by Section 185. So well, under the erstwhile Companies Act 1956, there was a press note from the MCA which stated that the Law Ministry has advised that deposits kept by one company with another company is loan as envisaged under Section 295/370. Keeping with this, loans under Section 395 will also include deposits. However, loans and deposits are of course not same. There are various case laws to prove this. Section 185 does not employ the same language as that of Section 370 of 1956 Act, wherein loans were taken to include deposits. Therefore, unless expressly specified by way of a clarification or similar, Section 185 may not include deposits. So let's have a few thinkers on Section 185. What is meant by ordinary course of business? The phrase does not mean principal business or main objects. Also, does not mean what is extraordinary in the ordinary course of business. What is extraordinary is classified under the head extraordinary items in the balance sheet. Any business which is carried on with regularity and frequency can be taken to be ordinary course of business. If, say, any manufacturing company has a separate treasury department dedicated to giving loans to directors, if such loans are forwarded only for financial accommodation of directors and not a separate line of business, then it is not covered. Are deposits covered? We just learned in the previous slide, the section does not make any separate distinction as such. Going by the case laws in this case, loans are different than deposits. The line of difference is very thin and circumstantial. Thus, deposits are not covered by the section. Are advances covered under Section 185? Advances are money advances against some due, which is to become due at a later period. It is a prepayment against goods or services, so advances are not covered. Does the section apply to book debts? Definitely. Section is applicable only if loan or loan is substances advance. This intent was also discussed in point 12.65 of the Standing Committees on Finance Report on Companies Bill 2009. Further, Section 296 of the Act 1956 made reference to book debts. If a book debt is prolonged beyond the usual credit period so as to allow more time to a debtor, such debt may also amount to a loan. Whether debentures are also covered under Section 185? Well, debentures are not covered by Section 185. The restriction of furnishing of security as used in 185 relates to security interest and not subscription of securities. In case of holding subsidiary relationship, can custom to act be assumed? No. This being not defined is purely circumstantial and up to the person alleging the same to prove. If it can be proved that instructions were given consistently and the board of the subsidiary applied such instructions without analyzing the rationale, then a custom to act can be established. So what if you don't comply with Section 185? The lending company shall be punishable with a fine of minimum 5 lakhs and maximum of 25 lakhs. Plus, every officer shall be punishable with imprisonment which may extend to 6 months or a fine of minimum 5 lakhs to 25 lakhs or both. The director or other person to whom the loan or guarantee or security is provided shall be liable to imprisonment of 6 months or a fine of minimum 5 to 25 lakhs or both. We must understand that even after the lightening or the changes with respect to penalties and fines due to the Injeti Srinivas committee and the change which has been brought by the ordinance in November 2018, this section has been kept intact and the word is still fine and not penalty. Therefore, if you are caught for non-compliance under this section, you will be liable for prosecution. So coming to the next section, section 186, which deals with loans and investments by companies. Let's have a quick snapshot. The section states that investment through more than 2 layers of investment companies are not allowed. Exemption for making foreign subsidiaries if permitted by foreign law, or exemption for such investment subsidiaries as required by law. One can say NBFCs, banking companies, insurance, government companies, etc. So what is the limit which has been prescribed in the section 186? The limit on giving of loan, guarantee or security to any person in which the employees of the company are not covered or any body's corporate in making investment in the securities of a body corporate is 60% of the paid up share capital, free reserves and securities premium account of the company in question, or 100% of free reserves and securities premium account, whichever is more. The above limits are not applicable for transactions between holding and its wholly owned subsidiary. The company is required to take a previous approval of its shareholders in case there is a breach of limits. Also, in case of subsistence of a term loan, the unanimous consent of the board as well as the public financial institutions concerned shall be required. The company has to provide full details of the loan, investment, guarantee or security as the case may be in its financial statements. Intermediaries which are registered under Section 12 of the SEBI Act, like the stock brokers and all, shall not take intercorporate loans and deposits in excess of the limits specified under the regulations applicable to such intermediaries. Further, company is also required to maintain a register in form MBP2, either physically or in electronic mode, which shall record all the transactions of giving or making of loan, investments, guarantees and security. Within 7 days of the transaction, such register has to be kept at the registered office of the company, and the entries have to be authenticated by the CS or any person authorized by the board. Now let's try and answer this question. Does the coupon rate on the issue of debentures being a security should be fixed in accordance with section 186/7? Well, the explanation provided in section 372/A of the erstwhile Companies Act 1956 to the effect that loan includes debentures or any deposit of money made by one company with another company not being a banking company is not provided in section 186. Therefore, compliance of 186/7 will not be mandatory in case of issue of debentures. Further, companies which have defaulted in repayment of their deposits are not allowed to make or give loans or make investments or guarantee security till such default subsists. So what are the exemptions provided under section 186? The exemption has been given to a loan, guarantee, security or investment made by a banking company, insurance company or a housing finance company, or a company which is established with the object and engaged in the business of financing industrial enterprises, or a company which is established with the object and engaged in the business of providing infrastructure facility. Further, the exemption has been given to any investment made by an investment company under a rights issue, or a rights issue by any body, corporate, or an NBFC whose principal business is acquisition of securities or investment made in respect of lending or investment activities. What's the correlation between these two sections, section 185 and 186? While section 185 mandates the lending companies to charge at the prevailing yield for the loans or guarantee or security in connection with such a loan, which attracts the provision in order to avail of exemption, section 186/11 exempts certain classes of companies from the section except for subsection 1. Subsection 7 lays down the requirement of charging a rate of interest at the prevailing yield of a government security. So the answer is, if a company is exempted from section 186, still, if the transaction attracts section 185, whether interest is to be charged at the prevailing yield. Yes, the interest should be charged at the prevailing yield if the transaction is one which attracts section 185. Here we'll say both the sections are independent sections. So coming to the next section, which is section 187, which simply mandates that a holding company or a company which has made investment should hold them in its own name. There's an exemption provided in case of a wholly owned subsidiary where the holding company can hold the investment in the name of its nominees. So thank you so much for being patient listeners, and you can read our other related resources at the link given on the slides. We shall look forward for your feedback to improve further. Thank you so much.